talk to you about staying passionate. Staying passionate. We're going to look at that verse in a moment. I need to tell you how the Lord has been working on my heart to get to this point today. Recently, we were back in my old home, Ventura, California, and that's where I had started in the ministry. And I was a youth pastor and working with kids. I loved every minute of it. And in order to do that, you need some youth leaders. You need people to come alongside and give you a hand. And one young man, he's about 5 years younger than me. His name's Jeremy Stevens. And let me show you a picture of him. There's Jeremy. A long time ago. That's like in the 90s. And Jeremy came along. He had just got his life right with the Lord, been involved with drugs, and just hadn't had a good life. And got his life back on path, following the Lord, fell in love with the Lord, and just began to serve God. And he was just a wonderful youth leader, and had a great time with him. I mean, we had so many laughs and fun, had great memories. He's still a very close friend. He was in our wedding, and last week I got to see him. I hadn't seen him in years and years and years and years, and so I took a picture. Jeremy would bring this little truck, and he on the back had a mobile detail business. And he worked so hard. He was the hardest worker. And he was passionate and still is about what he did. He did it with excellence. And he would show up at my office but he would show up and he'd detail my wash and detail my 98 Civic. And man, he made it look sweet. And it was you know, black and a lowrider, had some sweet rims on it. It was awesome. Okay? And he'd detail it out, it looked nice, and just fell in love with Jeremy. The guy was just passionate as can be. I ran into him last week. There he is. He's got a little bigger than I am, got a little more tatted up than I am. And he's awesome. He's just as passionate as ever. He has a company that's just thriving all over America in the detail business called Shine Supply. And I just sat there, and he's just as passionate as he ever has been. And his motto, in fact, Eric Hull, I know you follow Jeremy, and he sent this for you. So there you go. Little window down. His motto's always been, work hard, stay passionate. And I mean, he lives it out. He lives it out. It's awesome. It just rubs off on everybody who's around him. And I got home and I've been thinking about that. Staying passionate. Staying passionate. And passion is a difference maker. You see, it's what separates a guy like that. Not even talking about church at the moment, okay? It's what separates Jeremy in the detail world from the other guys. It's passion that sets him apart. And passion in life is a difference maker in any area of life. You see, it's the fuel that mobilizes warriors, literal warriors, to rush into battle. Because they believe in what they're fighting for. It motivates scientists to work and to fail and to keep trying, but to come up with new cures. It moves athletes to get up and run miles when you don't feel like it. You'd rather stay in bed. But it moves you to train, and it sustains ordinary people like you and me to keep pressing on and to reach the goals that we have as we go through life. You see, here's what happens. Passionate people are willing to do whatever it takes, and they're willing to make sacrifices for whatever their heart beats for passionately. And our hearts, I don't know if you notice this, but our hearts beat for a lot of different things, don't they? Okay? I just want you to know it's okay to be passionate about different things in life. Okay? God created you to be passionate. It's okay if you have something you're interested in and you're passionate about it. Awesome. By all means, be passionate. But we're passionate about sports. I mean, we get. So let's say you should have seen this. Parker, definitely Los Angeles Lakers fan. And recently they got this guy, which we've never really liked. But they got this guy named LeBron James to sign with them. And Parker, I mean, it's like he takes off his shirt, he goes out in the yard, in the front yard, it doesn't matter who's out there, woo! Swinging it. He's passionate about it. Okay? Let's say I'm like Adam Levine, call like my girls, and breaks, you can come too. Okay, let's like say, you know, it's, hello? Hey, Brinks, this is Adam. Okay, that kind of thing. And it's like, you want to do lunch? Like, what might you, how might you? It'd be awesome, right? Okay, we're passionate about movies. I mean, some of you people see more movies than have even been made. Okay, it was like, you know, it's amazing, but you're passionate about it. TV shows are certain. Wednesday night, I went out with the youth, the Chick-fil-A after youth, and they're all said, oh man, Netflix, like they binge on Netflix continuously. I watched 5 seasons last week of this one. I'm like, what? What else are you doing? When do you sleep? But they're passionate about it. Some people are passionate about music, about fashion. I mean, the kind of clothes we wear, as you tell, I'm very into that. Okay, food. I mean, we're passionate about food. There's certain things, man, if you eat that In-N-Out, it's kind of my thing. Okay, cars. People get crazy passionate about cars, about their politics. Oh, man. Do they ever? Family. Amen. Different causes. When I lived in Seattle, people would like put themselves in harm's way for the spotted owl. I'm just going to let this bulldozer run me over so I can save this owl behind me. And, you know, they're passionate about it. Okay? Rick, let's say the band Chicago asked you to come along on a tour.
I'm coming.
Would you be like halfway excited?
I'm there.
Okay? I'm thinking he just would be jazz telling everybody. Okay? Here's the point. You and I were created with the ability to be passionate. Passionate doesn't have anything to do with how old or young you are, all right? You can be passionate at any age. Passion has nothing to do with your personality, all right? You don't have to be an extrovert to be passionate about something or someone. Every single person, every one of us, was born with a God-given sense of passion. And I'm just here to tell you and remind you, the most passionate people in any town ought to be the people of God. There ought to be, I'm telling you, I've seen some of you call the hogs. And you get so crazy. And that's awesome. I love it. I mean, if I'm going to go watch a football game or something, I want you to be crazy. Okay, I'm going to get crazy with you. But we ought to be passionate about all things, but especially about Jesus. I mean, we got to be more passionate than anybody. Romans 12:11. I'm going to show you several different translations. But I like this verse. It says never. Everybody say never.
Never.
Never. Occasionally? No. It says never. Never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor serving the Lord. Now, zeal really is just a different word for enthusiasm or for passion. And the word fervor in that verse, it is translated from a Greek word, kopmet. And here's what it literally means. It means to bubble over. To bubble over or boiling over with interest or desire. So you ought to be bubbling over. Boiling over with interest and desire for spiritual things. For God Almighty, for Christ, for what God is doing and what is happening in the kingdom of God. Romans 12:11 is literally saying that our spiritual passion should be boiling hot. Bubbling over. Let me show you a few other translations. Common English Bible, I like this. Don't hesitate to be enthusiastic. Be on fire in the Spirit as you serve the Lord. Let's look at this one. Never be lazy, though, but work hard and serve the Lord enthusiastically or with passion. And then one more, and this is the one we're going to use today. It says, be enthusiastic to serve the Lord. Keeping your passion towards Him boiling hot, radiate I mean, you ought to be just glowing. You ought to, there ought to be, I ought to be able to get close and feel the heat. Radiate with the glow of the Holy Spirit and let Him fill you with excitement as you serve Him. Amen? You see, that's how you and I are designed and we're supposed to live. Jesus promised us this. He said in John 7:38, He said, "He who believes in me," who believes in Him? Anybody believe in Jesus in this room? So he who believes in me, the word says, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water. You know what that is? That's a life of passion. God designed and He desires for you and me to stay passionate in life. First and foremost about Him, but we ought to be passionate about our calling, our giftings, all those things. So stay passionate. Now let me give you just some observations. Here's what we're going to do today. I'm going to give you some observations regarding passion or zeal, or fervor, or enthusiasm, whatever word you want to use. But let's talk about passion. The first thing we all need to know, and in the coming weeks we're going to look at this topic. I want to challenge you to stay passionate with your family, to stay passionate in your giving, to stay passionate in serving the Lord, in your work, and all those things. But we need to know about passion itself. So first thing is this, passion isn't passive. Passion isn't passive. Passive is defined as this. If you're passive, you are lacking in energy. You're lacking in desire, willpower. You're motionless, you're idle, you're uninvolved, or maybe you're disinterested. Did you know you can't be enthusiastically passive? Woo! I'm passive! I am so passive! I'm the most passive person there is! It's awesome! Can't do that. Doesn't work, okay? Passion, what God wants us to be and designed us to be and how we're supposed to be in our life, it is active. I mean, it is expressed. You can't be passionate without it leaking out and being visible. People notice what you're passionate about. All I got to do is listen to what you talk about. Jeremy, you are a passionate hog fan. And you're passionate about the weather. I'm telling you, I like being with Jeremy because, I mean, he knows more about those things. It's awesome. And I just like, well, you can be talking about something else. And you turn that topic on, it's like, boom! Jeremy's all over it. And he's knowledgeable. And he loves to talk. And so it's expressed, all right? It's tangible. I mean, it's visible. It's evident in a person's life when we are passionate. It's on display for the world to see. All right? You know what I'm passionate about. It stands for something. Passion stands for something. It's like you draw a definite line and everybody knows it. It is not passive. I'm not quiet about it. I'm not hiding what I'm passionate about. But no. You can tell. You can just watch my life. You can see what I'm interested in, what I talk about. I'm passionate about it. So passion isn't passive. Okay? Let's talk about the second thing. Passion can be lost. Passion can be lost. Now, we all know that to be true. We know that passion can be lost. And we may look at this in greater detail in the future, but just for today, let me give you a visual picture of what happens and what can happen in passion. Let's see, I brought some balloons. Let's see if I can get them off here. So, some of you know, some of you were there. We used to meet over... It's not the YMCA anymore. It's not the Village Athletic Club. But it was a big gymnasium. The ceiling was really high. And we used to, every Sunday, we'd put balloons out early on for service. And we'd have a bunch of them. And your cousin would help me, Daryl. And we'd show up early and we'd put balloons, time on the seats and those kind of things. And we were celebrating church, right? Balloons kind of that thing. And so we'd have balloons. And usually what would happen is, we didn't get them all, like, out of the building after service. And for most of that next week, there'd be balloons up on this place, and, you know, where they had a business. But the church's balloons were up on the, way up on the ceiling, and you couldn't reach them. Let me give you, tell you why I'm saying that. Your passion, whatever you're passionate about, You gotta guard it, okay? Because it can be lost. I can do this, okay, without strength, obviously. And it can represent my passion at the moment. I mean, I can be passionate about something, so into it, and I mean, I just became a Christian, and I'm so thrilled with God, and I mean, I'm telling everybody, and I'm so excited about what He's doing in my life, and I mean, I'm passionate like crazy about something. But what can happen is life can become routine. Delays can come into our life. Things don't go exactly as we hoped or planned in those areas that we were passionate about. We wait, even though we've been passionate about it. And what can happen is we can begin to look. Somebody does us wrong. There's so many people that are married, passionate about each other, and one person. The passion's gone. Okay? You lost that love and feeling. Okay? And they've moved. Okay? What happens with these balloons, I'm just telling you, I may have all the passion in the world, but before too long, I'll just walk in here and pick them off the ground. Pick them up off the ground. And if we're not careful, our passion, we can lose our passion. We have to continue. And we're going to talk about this. But we have to work on being passionate. Okay? Third thing is this. Man, we're moving right along. Okay? Passion can be misdirected. Oh, haven't we seen it? Passion can be misdirected. Listen to what Paul says in Romans 10:2. He's writing about the love that he has for the people of God in Israel. All right? And he's describing them. He's saying, this is who they are. And here's what he says. I know what enthusiasm they have for God. Man, they are passionate. They've got enthusiasm for God. But, he says, it's misdirected passion. It's misdirected zeal. In Philippians 3:6, Paul is writing of his own past. He's talking about the thing that he used to be passionate about. And he says this, I was so zealous, or I was so enthusiastic, I was so passionate that I harshly persecuted the church. History is filled with misdirected passions. Hitler. And the list goes on. Right into our own neighborhoods, our own homes, our own lives. Misdirected passion, can I challenge you with this? It only causes a mess. It only ends up in a mess. It causes heartache and hurt. And so we have to be careful that our passion is in the right areas. We'll get into that. Fourth thing is this. Passion. Passion is a stimulus. Alright? You know what it is? It's a shot in the arm. Alright? It's fuel. It's a motivator. It propels us. It spurs us on. It's like that spur on the back of a cowboy that can't get that horse going. You want a little stimulus? Just kick that horse a couple times with that spur. I promise you that horse is going to move. Or it's going to move you off. Okay? And that's what passion is, a stimulus. All right? It does a couple things in our lives and in our world. First thing it does is it will energize you. Personally. It will energize you. The Stanford Research Institute and the Harvard Research Center, where I attended both of those. I promise you I didn't. But they discovered this. 15% of a person's success in life is determined by their knowledge or what they know. Okay, this doesn't help us with students in the room. Okay, 15% of what you learn. Okay? And here's what they did. Compare it with this. 85% of your success is determined by your attitude and specifically your level of passion, whatever it is you're doing. All right? Now, the opposite of passion or enthusiasm is apathy. And apathy never has energized anybody. It doesn't energize anybody. On the contrary, what it does, I'm telling you, you get around anybody who's apathetic and it drains you. It drains you. It drains you in passion. Passion delivers a power-packing punch, all right? It does something in our life. When you get passionate about something, you get interested about it. It starts to... I remember we used to have a Ford Flex, those big old station wagon things, blue, some of you remember it. And whenever we started looking at getting those, Bailey was a little younger, and she got interested. She'd spot them everywhere. All of a sudden, they'd always been there. But all of a sudden, Fortiflex, lights, Fortiflex. It's like little minion. Fortiflex. It was everywhere. You know why? Because they've always been there. But all of a sudden, there was a passion. All right, and she got excited and energized her in that realm, or that area, all right? Passion has the ability to pursue any of us towards something or a purpose. It's what can get you up in the morning. It keeps you working hard even when you don't see the results yet that you hope for. It's what has the power to fill the routine and even the mundane with joy and purpose, all right? It's what causes a single mother to work two jobs because she's passionate about her kids. It has that ability to energize us. And so then it does one other thing as far as the stimulus goes, but passion will inspire other people. It's contagious. Let me give you some examples. Let's say we all get invited to years ago to the Apple presentation where they're going to reveal the first iPhone. Okay? We all get to go to Cupertino and all that. I mean, I'd love to go to something like that. I think that'd be pretty neat. But let's say Steve Jobs walks out on stage to unveil the iPhone with little or no enthusiasm. What a downer. Or let's picture Walt Disney sharing the vision of Disneyland or Disney World. Magical kingdom. This one's in. It's like a little town. It's like the coming town. But he's not very passionate or enthusiastic about what he's going to do. And it's just like, okay. Turns out to be Frontier City, Oklahoma City. Something like that. I miss it. There's nothing fancy about it. You know, Frontier City. Okay? No, it's passion. How would it have been different if John F. Kennedy had shared his vision about putting man on the moon without any energy or any passion in his voice? What about Martin Luther King Jr.? I had a dream. Anybody remember what it was about? Would that not be the biggest downer? All these people on the Washington Mall. Oh. He had a dream. So did I. Okay? Passion inspires people. All right, listen to what 2 Corinthians 9:2. Paul is telling the Corinthian church this. He says, I keep boasting to the churches of Macedonia about your passion. They have a certain specific area of passion. It says your passion to give. And then he says this, your enthusiasm or your zeal, your passion, it's contagious. And here's what it's done. Because of your passion, this has happened. It has stirred many of them to do likewise. Nobel Prize winner, Sir Edmund Appleton, put it well, and he said this, in my work, I would rather have a second-class person with enthusiasm than a first-class person with apathy. The passion that you and I exhibit will impact the passion of everyone around you. It's true for your workplace. It's true for your family. Listen, Dad, if you get excited about family devotions or eating dinner together or praying together or doing things together as a family when your kids are young or at any time, you will lead the way. It's contagious. All right? It's true for your family. It's true for a church. In any area, without enthusiasm, without passion, growth of any kind, progress is always an uphill battle if there isn't passion. In fact, when it boils down to it, it's a crucial factor. You can't start a fire in someone else's heart until it's burning in your own heart. See, Walt Disney had to have that. He saw it before it was ever built. He was passionate about it. Steve Jobs was passionate. He knew what that thing could do. And before I could ever light a fire in anyone else's life and heart, it had to be burning in our own. And when it is, I mean passion will spread like wildfire. Five. Passion comes from within. Passion comes from within. I loved studying this part last week. I was educated thanks to this. I mean, I learned some things. We've all heard Ralph Waldo Emerson's quote. He said this. You may not know who he said it. They said, nothing great was ever achieved without enthusiasm. And the word enthusiasm, I like word origins. I like to study that kind of stuff. The word origin of enthusiasm, it's made up of two Greek words, okay? En, and it means within. And then the second part is theos, and that means God. All right. So the literal, original meaning of the word enthusiasm is God within. God within. So to be enthusiastic or passionate literally is to be inspired by the God, little g or big g, that's within you. Whatever you make a God in your life is what you will be passionate about. That's the literal meaning of the word. The key to being passionate about the right things is to have the right God as the priority in your life. Again, it's okay to be passionate about different things in your life, but this month, the right God, capital G, must be the priority in your life. You see, here's what happens. Excitement, we all get excited. Any of us can get excited. And excitement is the result of what happens outside of us. Okay? If we're in the right setting, I can be full-on depressed. But if I'm in the right setting, I can get excited for a few moments. Okay? I can get thrilled. But enthusiasm and passion is a result of what you've nurtured on the inside. It's what's inside of you. It is a reflection of the heart. You see, it's why the writer of Proverbs wrote this. Guard your heart. Guard your heart above all else. Why? Because it determines the course of your life. Whatever you're passionate about will determine the course of your life. It's going to guide your decisions. So what are you passionate about? Jesus expressed it this way. He said this in Matthew 6:21. He said, your heart will be where your treasure is. Here's what that means. You're going to be passionate about whatever you treasure most. I am very passionate about my family. I love spending time with my kids. And it's important to me that I find time, I make time to do that. Okay? I used to play golf all the time. Guess what? I got three kids, I don't play golf. Okay? Because I want to spend my money and my time with my kids. Someday I'm going to play again. But right now, that's my passion. And so your passion follows your treasure. You'll also put your treasure or your money, your time, your passions, you put those into whatever you're passionate about. And whatever your primary passion is, it will guide every area of your life. Now, a little bit ago, I had to raise your hand if you believe in Jesus and the love. As believers, your heart and my heart must be primarily for Jesus. And if it doesn't, we must repent. We must live in that state of confession, forgiveness, and repentance, and always making sure that he is my priority. You see, Jesus, think about this. I love reading about Jesus in the Gospels. That dude was passionate. I mean, he was crazy passionate. He was amazing. There was nobody ever on earth that was more passionate than Jesus. I mean, he was passionate. And now, his Holy Spirit is living inside of me. I mean, it's in me. He is in me, not it. He is in me. And if he is in me, let me just tell you, he's still as passionate as he ever has been. And if I'm not passionate about things that I know he's passionate about, something's wrong with me. Something's wrong with this guy. He's living in me. He's still passionate. And because he is living in me, that's why the verse that we read earlier, he who believes in me, out of his heart, out of his life, will flow rivers of living water. Passion is an inside job. You can't go to someone else and get passionate because of them. Okay? You can't learn how to. It's an inside job. And then the last thing is this. Passion. It can be, and it needs to be, and it has to be. Cultivated. It has to be cultivated. You might, in your Bible, Romans 12, 11, you may want to highlight or circle or underline the word keep or keeping in your Bible. Keep comes from a Greek word that means keep. Okay? And, you got that one. Okay. It's not real hard. It's the reason I said that. Yeah, you don't have to study real hard on this. Keep. Okay? Here's what that means. It's not automatic. It's not automatic. It's not just going to happen by osmosis, okay? You don't stay passionate for God or anything else automatically. You can't generate. It doesn't matter how many times you say or declare, I'm going to be more passionate. Oh man, I'm going to be more passionate. That doesn't matter. Now that's a pretty good place to start. That would not be a bad place to start. But the fact is, you have to feed your passion. You have to feed it. Enthusiasm, passion, just like any other habit or skill or something you want to do, it can be cultivated in your life. I'm going to go back to golf as an example. Okay? I told you, I used to play golf all the time. I've had more fun talking to Bill recently about golf. Hadn't anybody ever talked golf about it? Man, I love golf. It's like I was kind of like mediocre at all things. But like golf, I was a little above mediocre, so maybe it was nice. I loved it. It was just relaxing. I'd go outside, walk, and just enjoy. Love playing. I played multiple times over the week. And over the years, as I told you, I haven't played very often. In fact, I haven't played in years. And I've become, what's that word, passive. I've kind of gotten to the place I don't miss it a whole lot. I like to watch it a little bit, or if I had the opportunity, I'd probably go play, but it's not high on my priority list at this time in my life. And I'm more passive than passionate about it. But 2 weeks ago when we were in California, Jennifer's dad loves to play golf. Yes. And so we went and played like a couple times the week I was there. And I mean, boom! It was back! I mean, I just bet it like twice. That thing had been starving for years, and I just gave it a nibble, like, twice in 1 week, and I mean, it's like growling. All right, it's back. Right? It's like, man, I'm still in the ball. Man, that was fun. Now, let me use that as, let's move it around to any other area of your life, but especially your spirit. If you and I, we don't nourish, if we don't feed our spirit, you can declare you can be passionate all you want. But if you don't feed that, your heart's going to grow cold. And it's going to grow passive towards the things of God. And I want to suggest this. There's a lot of ways to feed our spirit. But this verse gives us, to me, this verse gives us the surest, most definite way to cultivate passion and to keep your enthusiasm for God boiling off. And what it is it's serving you and serving other people. You see, I'm serious about this. You need to be reading your Bible. You need to be worshiping. You need to be in church. But if you want to feed your passion for the things of God, for His kingdom, find some place and some way to do it where they sit. And you just watch. You watch. Your passion will begin to boil over for whatever it is you're pouring yourself into. It doesn't happen. We get it wrong. We wait around, and I used to have this with kids in youth groups all the time. They want to wait around until they got motivated to do something. That's not the way it works. You do something, and the passion comes. You do something, and the motivation builds. You find a place that you're being used, and great things are happening, and you're valued, and you're making a difference, and all of a sudden, your passion for that area grows. It's amazing. Your passion will be to grow the Lord. Be enthusiastic to serve the Lord, keeping your passion towards Him. Boiling hot, not warm, boiling hot, radiate. I mean, people around you ought to feel. Radiate with the glow of the Holy Spirit and let Him fill you with excitement when? As you serve Him. You want to get excited about the things of God? Start serving Him. Start putting your life to work in the kingdom of God. Now, in closing, I want to remind you, you aren't meant to live without passion. You're supposed to be passionate about things. Jeremy, God gifted you. I keep picking on you, I'm sorry. But God gifted you musically. Guess what? It is perfectly in order and right and fine and should be that He is passionate about music. That's part of how God created Him. You ought to be passionate about music. I mean, you ought to be. You pour your life into it, right? It's awesome. You're passionate about your family. I know you are. But we must be passionate first and foremost about Him. You see, none of us were meant to live stagnant, passive, passionless lives. And to me, that's good news. That means God didn't intend for you to live a boring life. Why? Because we serve an extraordinary God, amen? We serve a God who's not boring, amen? We serve a God who can do everything, amen? We serve a God for whom there are no impossibilities, amen? You see, we serve a God who makes a practice. It's in His DNA. He makes a habit of doing exceedingly abundantly, above and beyond anything that you or I could ever dream or imagine. That's not boring. That's passionate. And you and I are called to be a reflection of Him. Not the world, but a reflection of Him to the world. Filled with passion. And the truth is, because I've experienced it, most of life can be incredibly routine. It can be mundane. And you have to work to keep things fresh in any area of your life. And we have to put effort into staying passionate about our jobs, our relationships, our dreams, our hobbies, and most importantly, our walk with the Lord. Every single day, you have to purpose to stay passionate. Just like my buddy Jeremy, who every day gets up and he looks at that. Work hard on those things. And he purposes it. You see, you and I have to steadily stir ourselves up. We have to, as Paul said to Timothy, you got a fan in the flame. You want that fan, that flame to grow? You want that passion to increase? You got to fan the flame. Alright? Why? So that we radiate with the glow of the Holy Spirit. Stay passionate. Work hard. Stay passionate. You're designed for it. It's what God intended.